Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Ganesh Parmar, and it is indeed my pleasure to welcome each one of you and lots of our viewers to the Dabur Red Presents Arth, a Culture Fest. Arth, a Culture Fest is a multi-regional cultural festival. It is a quest. It is a quest to find a new meaning. It is a quest to find a meaning in art and culture. We would be across these 2 days, considering yesterday as well, we would be talking about art, culture, history, society, and these are just few of the things that we will try to delve into. You will have an opportunity to listen to few of the finest speakers from our country and abroad. So, ladies and gentlemen, we would like to go ahead further, and before we start, I would like to take a short opportunity to thank our sponsors. Our presenting sponsor, Dabur Red Paste, keeps dental problems away, promoted by Z, supported by Z News. Our exclusive digital partner, Z5, print partner, DNA, event partner, Incredible India, radio partner, Red FM, multiplex partner, Inox, food curation partner, Kala Swasti, English news channel partner, Republic TV, production partner, Scoop, campus outreach partner, Think India, student partner, Dusu, digital outreach partners, Your Story, My Nation, shopping partner, DLF Shopping Mall, and our outreach partner, Spick McKay, Blue Lemon Entertainment. With this, ladies and gentlemen, we'd also like to thank our live audiences here. Thank you very much for joining us this morning. And we would like to welcome in our first panelists now. The first discussion that we would like to stage for you has a topic, Activism via the Arts, Legitimate or Opportunistic. Now, considering this, we would first like to invite our moderator, Ms. Shubhrastha, who is a writer. She has co-authored her book, The Last Battle of Saraighat. She's been an ex-political campaign consultant with the BJP, and she's worked with All India Radio as a newsreader. Let's have a round of applause and welcome her onto the stage, please. Welcome, ma'am. Your choice, wherever you feel comfortable. Let me now take the pleasure of welcoming our panelists onto the stage. To begin with, I would invite Dr. Ananda Shankar Jayant. She is a celebrated, eminent, and renowned classical dancer, choreographer, and a dance scholar. She is a Padma Shri awardee and also has been awarded with the Sangeet Natak Academy Puraskar for Bharatnatyam. Dr. Ananda is a motivational speaker and actively engages herself with young Indians on a wide range of topics. Let's please welcome and have a round of applause for Dr. Jayant. So very warm welcome to you. She's also conceptualized and created the Natyarambha, a first of its kind digital art initiative. Let me also welcome on stage Malavika Avinash. She's a member of several boards of cultural bodies of the Government of India. Let's have a round of applause while she welcomes and walks onto the stage, including the Kala Kshetra Foundation, Chennai and IGNCA, SRC in New Delhi. And let me also tell you that she's a trained classical dancer and a musician and had an early foray into films as a child artist as well. Very warm welcome to you, ma'am. Finally, let me also welcome on stage Swarnamalya Ganesh, a performer with over 35 years of experience. Let's welcome in with a thunderous applause, Ms. Ganesh, who's here with us. A scholar of dance history, as well as a trained academician in art practice and sociology. Her PhD dissertation was on research and reconstruction of lost dance repertoire of medieval South India. Some of her eminent contribution to the critical theories on performance history addresses the notion of classical and Bharatnatyam, sex and gender in performance, to mention a few. And finally, ladies and gentlemen, our last panelist, please welcome on stage Mr. Vivek Agnihotri, a renowned film director, producer, and a screenwriter, and I'm sure a lot of us are waiting to hear from us. He's worked on numerous genres, including thrillers, sports movies, political dramas, erotic, and romance. And his debut as an author was in 2018 with the book Urban Naxals. Ladies and gentlemen, I will leave you with this eminent panelist and the moderator. Over to you, ma'am.
Thank you so much for conceptualizing this session and giving us this illustrious panel. So let's format it in such a way that we'll have a 2 to 3 minute opening remarks from each one of you so that the audience also knows the context and perspective, and then we shall get into a interactive mode. So would you like to begin, Ananda ji?
Good morning. Thanks, Varasha. Arts and activism, are they intertwined or are they exclusive? This is probably the pathway of today's chat in the morning. To a large extent, artists stay within the world of art, but more often than not, an artist is also a social animal, a political animal. And I have always believed that my art is also my language. Just as I speak English or Hindi, my language is also my art. And there are times in an artist's life where you will want to speak about the issues around you, social or otherwise, through the language of your art. And most of us do that. And most of us have been doing it. And then we also come back to doing art for art's sake, art for the rasika, art for your own growth, all that is all there. But the problem, I think, is when you start using the art, and it's a Lakshman Rekha, actually. Where does it stop being what you're doing to make a point on the social changes that you want to bring around you? And where does it go to another level where it is politicizing your art? I think that is a Lakshman Rekha that artists themselves draw, and some step over, some don't. But I think art, boxing art into being just not being part of the social system, I think that may not be possible, because after all, we are part of the same milieu.
Vivek ji.
Good morning, everyone. Okay, so art and activism. First of all, thank you for inviting me. Very wonderful people here, and a lot of activism. All of them are activists. First, let's understand what is not activism. Because these days, what has happened is anybody who says something against anything we say, he's an activist. Yesterday or day before, Mr. Narendra Modi made a brilliant speech in Parliament. And if you remember, he said that some 20,000 NGOs were shut down in the last few months. Now, what these NGOs were doing? Before that date, when they shut down, they were all activists. So we have to, it's very important to understand what is activism and who is an activist. First of all, having an opinion is not activism. Everybody can have opinion. Rebelling against something is not activism. Agitating is not activism. Activism is bringing about a constructive change. Stone pelting is not activism. Jihad is not activism. Now, somebody using art to create conflict in the society and painting as activism, which a lot of people do, is not activism. In art, I'll talk primarily from cinema's point of view. If you really want to see who did genuine activism in cinema, you have to look at B.R. Chopra's films. When you look at B.R. Chopra's films, all these modern age feminists will have a lot to learn from that. What activism actually means, what I have learned through experience and what I understand, is when you identify there is a genuine problem which can be against your nation, state, a society, something which basically is degenerating society or stopping the evolution of human beings, that's when you identify that problem and you raise your voice, and it can be, and you have to take it to a logical conclusion. Just agitating something, just starting the process of manthan and not taking out the ghee or the dahi out of it is not activism. That is just creating nuisance, just creating disturbance. Now, what has happened in India specifically, and in fact most of the democracies, activism is one of the best paid jobs. Activism has become a mafia. In India, if you look at professors, they are activists. Legal activism, just few days ago, when I was, few years ago, when I didn't know about everything, I used to think Prashant Bhushan and all these people, I'm sorry, I'm taking name, because Supreme Court has taken the name. I used to think that when the Narmada Andolan was happening, I genuinely participated in that. Do you know that? I was part of that. I thought I was activist and I was working for a genuine cause. It's only, and Medha Patkarji, I know her very well, great lady, and Prashant Bhushan and all these people were running that, and they were the leaders of that active that movement. Just few days ago, Supreme Court has said this. When they were saying why you wrote their name in their book, now Supreme Court has said this.
So Vivek,
that they are bringing shame to legal judiciary of this country by this. Agitation is not activism. Activism is correcting the few issues in the society and taking it to a logical conclusion.
Swarnamalya ji, do you agree? Do you disagree? Do you what do you have to add to that?
Sure. A very good morning. Thank you for having me here. Before I respond to Vivek ji's comments, I think I'd like to begin by pondering upon art and activism. And if we were to define activism in a broader sense, not just Andolan, but to look at it as a means to a change, as he rightly put it, then I think art has always mainstreamed being a part of the social milieu for many, many years. I'm also talking about it from a historical point of view. Artists, the personal is always political. So artists have never, and I'm not even talking about just the 21st or the 20th century, but even in earlier centuries than that, when you look at the lives and the work of artists, be it the community artists, the hereditary community artists, be it musicians, their work has always reflected their personal opinion and has also been part of diplomacy. And I think that's a very, very important aspect to art that that I think sometimes we tend to forget. So it's very important to place art in the context of not just entertainment, but also as a very important tool towards not propaganda, but towards being a part of a social change. So in that sense, I do not think that art can be separated from what today we might call as activism, but I would like to broaden that scope and think of it as diplomacy, think of it as part of a social change. Having said that, to respond to Vivek ji's comments on what is activism, while I agree that there might be a lot of noise making in the activism realm, I also think that change begins somewhere, and that change has to begin at a place where one has to have a voice of dissent. And that could be anywhere, that could be in any form. And art, I think, is a very affirmative, at the same time, a very affable, if I can use that term, way of putting across your dissent. You do not have to be vocal, you do not have to stand with your arms up. And I think art is a fantastic tool in that sense. So I do think that activism through art is very effective, can be very affirmative. It can also be very gentle. At the same time, very affirmative. So I do think that to art, activism is important. And to activism, art is very important. And they give in to each other. And to respond to that again, I would think that change has to begin somewhere. So I do not think that raising your voice or raising your opinion against another's could necessarily be nothing. It is a beginning to a change.
Malavika ji, you are not just an artist, you are also a politician. And the word activism, I think, needs a response from an artist who chooses to continue as a politician as well. What do you think about the distinction between art and activism? How do you draw that line?
Hari Om, and thank you for having me on the panel. There have been some rich opinions that have come forth, and these are all artists in their own right, and therefore, I suppose they have an opinion, they stand by. I don't know if it's a coincidence or a choice that I am both in the arts and in politics, and both these terms are being very broadly used, I would think. Art as in what kind of art? What is your form? Yes, every form has a purpose, has an audience, has its own limitations, and the artist who pursues that form has to be true to the form first, more than to himself. I think that's the primary responsibility of every artist. So if that is the case, art, according to me, is the Shanti Mantra. And activism is the Kranti Mantra. And they are completely opposed to each other. So for me, I think I wouldn't call it activism. I'm a politician. So politics is one step ahead of just activism or social activism, or like Vivek ji said, you know, just an agitation, because a politician has a greater responsibility because he is there, after all, chosen to govern. So he cannot just agitate and keep quiet. So for me, they are mutually exclusive, especially because of the forms that are chosen. Because every form has an origin. When you say Indian classical music, the origin is in Samaveda, not in Karl Marx's book, you see. So, you know, from Samaveda on to Bharata's Natya Shastra, where it was given a form and structure. In fact, Natya, which is dramaturgy, that was given a form as early as the 5th and the 3rd and the 4th and the 1st century BC. All right. And then subsequently, there was Abhinavagupta, there was a Bhakti movement, then there was an Islamic invasion, and then the British came. So much has changed. Much has changed, but the origin cannot. And when you have an origin to a form, then there is a purpose to that form. And what is the purpose? The purpose is to elevate yourself and elevate the audience. So if this is the process of me getting elevated and you getting elevated and both of us transcending this very reality, then the question of fighting the reality of an activist does not arise at all. They are completely opposed to each other, according to me. And you are given a phone like this. All of us carry a smartphone, don't we? And we all know the use of the phone. What is the use of the phone? Is to speak or to communicate, is to WhatsApp or whatever. But if you think, no, I'm going to throw this at the next bat that comes my way, let me play cricket with it, then your choice, boss, is your phone. But then that was not the purpose for which the phone was created. So every form has, at least the artist has the responsibility of holding on to the form and using it for the purpose it was made for. Or you are being irresponsible to the audience. The audience does not come to watch you do your activism. Activism has a different platform. And there is an audience there too. So whether you fuse it, you mix it up, or whether the art and the artist should be confused, whether the artist and the art form, all of this needs to go into consideration. You can't broaden this. In India, the arts are much larger than it is elsewhere. And it has a very, very deep spiritual meaning to it, which perhaps fewer other cultures can offer.
Swarnamalya ji, while you spoke about gave your initial remarks, you mentioned something, I find it very provocative, that everything personal is political. And here you have a Malavika ji who says that whether it is political or not, art and activism should be mutually exclusive. So here are two different schools of thought, and I think that the debate goes as far back as the classical times. So how do you respond to this new movement today, and allow me the freedom to interpret it as a as the Indic Renaissance, when you are really looking back at India with a lot of pride, with a lot of sense of responsibility, and on the other hand, you have a group which, or a lobby which believes that everything that India signifies is that of oppression, is that of conflict, there are no places for confluence, and only through activism and only through widening of these gaps can solutions come. So how do you respond to these two different schools of thought as an artist?
You see, I think history is interpretation. So if there is one interpretation to history, there is going to be another opposed interpretation. Mm-hmm. Having said that, the facts that are laid down before us, again, facts are also, you know, you can also interpret facts in the way that you wish, but
can you interpret facts, because opinions on facts can be interpreted,
right?
But how do you contest facts?
No, but sometimes, you know, for example, historical facts are also contested, because sometimes we do not have enough evidence to certain historical claims, and then, you know, that is contested, and it's debatable in many a times. However, you know, I think that as an artist,
let me put it in a nutshell: ekam sat vipra bahuda vadanti. This has been a belief for several centuries. This is not something that was discovered in the last 200 years with activism and all that. This is something that our forefathers have said several centuries ago.
I just wanted to, listening to two ends of the spectrum, I'm trying to understand this. Is it because over the last few decades, or even a century maybe, that the arts and the artists have been enormously marginalized? And I'm talking of the performing and the visual arts. Is that the reason that artists are going out of their, comfort zones of being in the art world? And is it a reason to find a face, to find relevance, to be seen as being part of the system? Because to a large extent, most artists feel that they are out of every boundary. I think, is the problem there? The problem is that we have marginalized art and artists and trivialized it to mere entertainment. And hence, maybe artists are trying to find themselves. And because this seems to be a good pathway, flagging a cause, which is fine if you really believe in it. But then using your art to be part of that, some people do it as language, as I said, some people do it as a political statement. So maybe if you go back a few steps and make art relevant in the educational scenario, in the social scenario, and make it not just performance and entertainment, maybe, then this distinction might shift.
You wanted to add something.
One small word, Shubhrastha, to what Ananda ji is saying. She spoke of using art for activism. I don't know if it should be redefined as using your artistic status, a certain recognition that the people have given you for the art that you perform. You know, using that artistic status to convey a political point.
That too.
Yeah. So, I mean, going back to the question of the personal being political, what I meant to say is that when an artist engages with a social issue, or when they're engaging with any issue for that matter, I think there is a sense of belonging as well. Many a times, you know, if you look at, for example, I'm jumping ahead, but if you look at the Me Too movement that happened in the classical world recently, at least in the South, as I hear, it's going to happen in Mumbai in a few days, is what I hear. But anyway, so that is a very personal movement for most of the artists. It was a moment that everybody had to own up to the very unsafe environment that they were living and working in. So it became very personal, and it became a question of having to cleanse or having to look at the very atmosphere in which you thrive. So in that sense, one cannot stay away from that kind of activism, because if you do, then you are in many ways condoning the very unsafe environment you're providing yourself and your peers.
Was it that black and white, Vivekji? Because you have been a victim / survivor of the Me Too movement too.
That is bullshit. I'm a film director. I can ask anybody to change any clothes on the sets or inside the makeup. Well, that's bullshit. So let's not get into that. See, and I don't want to get into it because, see, the problem is today that the kind of leftist mafia which operates in this country, first, let's understand, is it possible for any movement to succeed by excluding the other party? For example, let's look at the caste issue. In India, we are suffering from this for long, long years. Do you realize, and this is very important to understand in the context of Me Too, do you realize that if on 15th August 1947, the oppression index was 100, which means 100 out of 100 upper caste people were oppressing lower caste people on 15th August 1947. Where do you think it is today? Hasn't it come down? I've been asking this everywhere. It has come down by 60-70% in 70 years, which is a great success. It's really great success for 1,000-year-old bad tradition to come down. Today, nobody oppresses upper caste people, at least in cities, they definitely, and the villages also, they don't. Nobody talks about that, and we create a kind of a fake narrative around it. You can never win caste problem by excluding the upper caste from the activism. Similarly, Me Too movement can never ever succeed by excluding men out of it. If you really want women to be empowered, you have to include men by excluding them, by abusing them, by accusing them. You cannot do it. And let me tell you, statistics, if somebody believes in it, almost 90% of these cases are done for publicity, not for seeking justice. Because all of them are, it's a failed movement all over the world. It's a political weapon, do you know that? It's a political weapon which is, I'm sorry, I'm not against you. If it is a personal, it's like there is food available here. Now suddenly I'm upset with something and I start agitating and I call the press and I sit down here and I start accusing and abusing all these food vendors here. Did I exploit the possible avenues? Did I go to the organizers and said the food is not correct? Did I go to the court? Did I use anything? How is it possible that suddenly you get up and you say, this is wrong, and you accuse the person when the other person has no chance to say anything?
Okay.
So that's why I think it's absolutely failed and going in the wrong direction. Me Too movement alone will do more harm to Indian women than anything else in this world.
Swarnamalya ji, I'm sure you definitely do not agree with that. But I wanted to understand from you, do you think the Me Too movement, the way it spanned across, not just, you know, South India, it happened in Mumbai as well. It happened in the journalistic circles in Delhi. And do you think the movement did injustice to itself and women who were vocal about it on social media and beyond did a huge injustice to the very movement by excluding a voice that you yourself talked about, you know, democratization of spaces, reinterpretation of facts and reinterpretation of history? Do you think men had a say there? And if not, then was the Me Too movement motivated and propagandist?
From where I see it, I think the Me Too movement, although, you know, the percentage of the number of women who came out is definitely much higher, at least from the arts world, I can speak from the performing arts world, there were tremendous amount of voices of the men that were also heard. Men who were victimized. I mean, I personally had so many of my friends who came out and spoke about the kind of abuse and the kind of you know, volatile atmosphere that they had to fester themselves in. And they were also speaking about how helpless they felt. See, I think the Me Too movement is speaking to power. And largely, whether it is a man or a woman, it was the power structure, invariably, that made a place very hostile for a person to thrive, whether it be a man or a woman. Also, I think the idea that the Me Too has not moved for, the very reason why the Me Too movement, I think, erupted the way it did was because due process was not due enough. There were no systems in place in most of the, at least I can speak from the performing arts sector, it's a very unorganized space where there are no redressal mechanisms, there is not even a person you can reach and speak to. So when due process is not due enough, what happens is this collective voice emerged and it took a few. Maybe it was in a very different realm. But I remember when the first Me Too wave happened and people started speaking in the art world, everybody just backed off. It took more than a year for another wave to emerge and for young people to find who can be reached safely. So I think the entire question of anonymity, the question of pulling up someone, all of this, as disruptive as it sounds and looks, where was another way? There wasn't another way. The systems did fail us.
So according to you, it was inevitable and a necessary inevitability. Malavika ji, I'll come back to you because I, given the situation that exists and given the problems that exist, do you think there is a way in which we could structure this entire unrest within the artists, not really the art, to channelize this kind of energy into a more structured format? And do you think the art world can be made a better place by putting certain structures in place?
No, I think fundamentally where we come from, your thought processes, your ideology suggests what your perspective of the world is. I, for one, believe that it's a beautiful world with beautiful things in it. Yes, a few have gone wrong. I have a heritage that I am proud of that no other civilization has. I am Hindu and therefore, you know, I am what nobody else is. So I come from that space. But if you are going to look at all the evils of this society alone and say it's all because you're Hindu, then I have a problem with you, because where isn't such evil? Are you telling me that other societies don't? So it depends on what your perspective is, what your ideology is, where you come from. That you see only the, some see only the negative, some of us see a lot of the positive. I am not saying the negative should not be corrected. In fact, when what Swarnamalya did mention was, there was a buzz about a year ago, much before what came to the fore, and turned out to be a small kind of, an unrest, an uprising, which of course she was part of. But what came before that was indeed startling. There were several professors named, there were several artists named, and indeed we were stunned and shocked too, in amazement that these are people who have such dark sides to themselves. And therefore, they had to be addressed. By hushing it up, you're not going to serve anything. But then, by speaking up what was served is my question. Because there are specific cases in South India. I'll give you a classic example of this very Me Too. There was a singer in Tamil Nadu who spoke up against a perceived, an atheist, a DK person. And she was called a stooge of the BJP. In Karnataka, there was a girl, an actress, who spoke up, who was seemingly liberal and left and all of that. And she spoke up against an actor who was seemingly on the other side. Therefore, they said, oh, it is the left propping up this girl. So we do not know who's propping up whom and whether there's propping up. But to me, what happened to those two is what matters. Because I look at what was attempted to be achieved. Yes, there was a sense of relief, perhaps, which is what the woman needed at that moment, to just say it. You know, you don't have to go to a police station. You don't have to go to any court. I just want to say it. I want to come out with my truth. Could have been the position at that time. But what came of it? Were they ready for it? It was flagged off, but what came of it? Yes, and how many achieved that logical resolution that it should have? Instead, I think it was the women that lost work, and multiple things happened to them. So I won't go into the details of what happened, because it's again their own personal experience and their choice of dealing with it. But then, I don't know, you just suddenly go with the flow, and then you shouldn't be left alone. You should know where you're headed. And there somewhere, I think this entire movement failed those women who were led to speak, and then what happened?
Ananda ji, do you agree? Do you disagree? What do you think about bringing structure to the art world? Is that possible? And may I add the lobbying question here? Should we make lobbying officially legal?
Yeah, I think the essential nature of the world of arts is and I think its strength is also in its lack of structure. I come from the world of extraordinary structure and hierarchy. I come from the world of governance and bureaucracy. What happens is, in any corporate or government situation, you have to clear your exams or your interviews, and then you enter the system. And the system has very well laid out, pathways. And unless you're really bad, your growth in the system is almost,
you know, dependent completely on you. But in the unstructured, heavily unstructured world of arts, the doorway is guarded by a person or persons. The entry is governed by these people, and the growth and the how you rise in that field is governed by a few. And I think that is where you find all the more the problems of, you know, whether it's Me Too, whether it is lack of growth, whether it's lack of being there. And as Swarnamalya rightly said, what is needed today is to bring in structures. We already have structures in the government sector which are working. I'm not saying they're perfect, but at least they're working. At least we're able to indict a few people, you know, at least call them out. But processes are important. You cannot have kangaroo courts, that I'm clear about. You have to have clear processes. You have to have clear people who understand what's the problem, legal, and this can be done for the unstructured world. It's not impossible. It is difficult to implement, but if you put, we're all, you know, intelligent people, if we put our minds to it, I think that structure is needed. If you do not have that structure, as Vivekji said, what about the other side? How can they voice their opinion? I mean, there are two sides always. So I think structure is important. And going to the second question of lobbies, the very world of art is, I mean, I think all of us are very lobby driven, but the world of art in its nature has lobbies, and which is sad because you love me, you love my dog, you love my dog's tail and poop, it goes to that extent. So it's almost sad, in the dance world, there are many extraordinary artists out there, and I'm sure Vivekji will agree with me, in the film world too, who need to be there out, but because they don't belong to this group of people who do not align politically in that way, or who do not, I think they lose out. So if you ask me, lobbies are not good, of course, but somehow some kind of transparency needs to come into the world of selection of artists, how they perform, how you rate them, how you grade them, and I don't like the word opportunity either. We all believe that we have to give someone an opportunity. Opportunity is a foul word. I don't like it. I believe that we all grow into being the artist you are by the strength of your art, and society needs to stop trivializing the arts, and I think more often than not, besides the very political need of activism, I think most artists use the pathway of activism for a cry of recognition.
Can I add to the structure part, because we have worked on it? See, we live in a very mixed up world, you know. The problem is, let's look at the film industry. In fact, 70-80% of this entire movement came from the film industry. It's so glamorous, and media gives you coverage. Nobody gives coverage to Beti Bachao, Beti Padhao. I've been traveling in villages. Such great work is happening where structures are being put into place. So many beneficiaries. Nobody talks about it. That is real, genuine activism. But since it's come from the government, and not from the government, so many NGOs and individuals are working. Let me give you two examples. And you will understand the hypocrisy of this activism. In film industry, no woman was ever allowed to do makeup. Do you know that? Even heroines, even actresses' makeup, there was an association, Makeup Artist Association, and there was a law for so many Indian, Bollywood, Hindi film industries there for 100 years. In 100 years, women were not allowed to do makeup.
Vivekji, I think you have to specify for the audience how we understand makeup, they don't.
No, let
He's
me,
speaking
let me,
of
let me,
the
let
makeup
me.
Artist.
No, I know how to explain it. Wait one second. I know how to explain it. No, I will. They understand. When we act, there is one person who does your hairstyling and one does makeup, right? You know, they will understand. I'm an intelligent audience. So they were not allowed to do makeup. Till this moment when I'm talking to you, the studios do not have proper toilets for women. If you are shooting outdoors, men just stand outside and they start peeing. Women have no facility. And no producer worth his salt ever thinks about it. There's never ever those facilities made available. Now, I want to ask this question. All these people, all these actresses who were taking this placard, including right from top, all producers and directors, the placard in Bombay Times front page, that we feel and care so much about women, don't you think anything about those hairstylists, assistant directors, all these women? Today, film crew has at least 50%, more than that. In fact, in the films I've been working, there have been 60-70% film crew. Nobody ever thinks about it. If you're genuinely concerned, if your activism is genuine about women, you want really to protect them, start from there, number one. Second thing, what this activism has done now, today, most of the studios, almost all of the studios, whether somebody says it or not, everybody has stopped hiring girls. All the directors, male directors, have stopped hiring girls. Earlier, at least out of 6 or 7 assistant directors, 4 or 5 used to be girls. That number is going down. What you have done is, in such a wonderful art, in such a wonderful profession, where nobody cared whether you're a woman or man, it was just talent which mattered, where there was so much of openness between two genders, now you have created mistrust. People stop trusting each other. And I think that is the biggest harm this kind of misguided activism has done.
Would you want to add something?
Sure.
And then we'll open the floor to the to questions.
No, I'd like to respond to one of what Anandaka said about artists. You know, I'll talk from my personal experience. Being an artist, being an activist was never on my agenda. And I still don't consider myself an activist because I think I'd agree with Vivekji. That is a full-time job. Somebody has to be at it. I mean, it is something that you have to put your heart into, and I'm not an activist. However, when I was pushed in the middle of a movement that was happening, and I was caught in this whirlpool, without realizing, I had become an activist. You know, when I was speaking up for myself, when I was speaking up for my colleagues, whose voices were lesser heard than mine, whose access to media was definitely lesser than mine, without my realizing it, I had become an activist. And I do not see an upside to this at all. If anything, I was disinvited to events. So I think the idea that this kind of activism leads to some kind of positive publicity. Now, somebody might argue that any publicity is good publicity, but I do not think so, because I think the kind of backlash, the term we use is gaslighting. The kind of gaslighting, the kind of backlash that women and men have faced who have spoken up against or stood up to power. And statistics tells us that, you know, people who have been part of the movement have undergone tremendous amount of backlash for years together. Nobody thought about it. None of us thought about what is going to happen. So that it does not mean that it is not without, hindsight or foresight. It was a moment of calling. And when that moment of calling, I'm not talking about other kinds of activism, I'm being specific to the Me Too movement here. What happened was everybody was speaking up. And you know, someone like me, whose stories were also out there, even I, with all the strong voice that I had, even I didn't have the courage to speak about my story as myself. I had to shield myself behind the anonymity, because the kind of backlash and gaslighting that there was tremendous. So I think activism in that realm has no upside to it. It has, if anything, it has only given us negative publicity. So I don't think that it can legitimize your position.
So the activists who raised voice for or against Me Too didn't benefit from it. Yeah. Women in general, there has crept a gender bias into hiring and
Can I add to that, if you don't mind? See, I think if we look at immediate change, we might not have had a tremendous change to look for. But for example, we pushed for the internal complaints committee to be set up in a very unorganized sector. And I'm very proud to say now Chennai Federation of Sabhas has an internal complaints committee.
But Shankar Guidelines was there for a long time, just because artists chose not to,
it wasn't there at all. It wasn't there at all. There was absolutely no redressal. And, you know, institutions like the Music Academy, who 1 year ago, when one of the, alleged perpetrators was on their panel, when they sent him out silently when that, you know, when the first wave happened. In the second wave, because it was much larger and so much more vocal, they had to wake up and they had to speak up about it. And I think the fact that we have a panel today discussing safety, discussing the idea of some kind of, you know, voices that emerge out of different industries, I think that by itself is step one. And I don't think we should immediately look for a tremendous amount of social. It will happen. I do believe that the movement is not died down. It's not a fad. It is the creation of systems in place. It takes time. So we must have the patience.
I just want to ask as a curiosity, since I am the only man, do you guys also point out all those women who use it as an extortion
means? Absolutely.
Have you done any name? Have you so far pointed out
yes.
any girl or woman who has yes. extorted people?
Absolutely.
Can you name somebody who has done that?
No, I don't want to name them. Because
no, you can name men. You can't name somebody who extorts.
No, I haven't named the men either.
Can we please?
No. Yeah. No, I'll keep it impersonal, but I'll also respond to that. When the Me Too movement happened, at least 2% of the cases that came out were, you know, vindictive in nature. And when people understood that that's how it was, there was absolutely no question in standing up for those men. In fact, we had a forum which we created parallelly. And you know, the very fact, I mean, I'd also go back to the first initial comments all of us made about truth. And the fact that there are two sides to the story, there are two truths. The men who came up and spoke, the so-called alleged perpetrators, they had their version. And these were all very highly regarded and respectable men, and their voices, whether they are respectable or not, have to be heard. That's how the whole democratic setup works. So, you know, when we had a public hearing, everybody was allowed to speak. And those cases, Vivekji, where there was vindictive blaming, those were also put out. I mean, there is absolutely no question of victimizing.
No, I have no problems. I think it's a great thing. All women should be. One second. But the only thing is that why so hungry for media? Can't you make small community discussions?
It didn't happen.
Why only media? Or does it exist only on media? Why? Aapne khud hi abhi when you were talking, you said, I did it because I could attract media. You said that when you were talking.
No, I didn't say that. I said
lesser voices couldn't reach.
But you do need a forum, don't you? You need a platform. We are speaking here because there are so many people listening.
Okay, I think I'll put my foot down as a moderator and would want the panel to move from me to take some audience questions.
No, I think the larger activism was lost in just Me Too. I think the activism that comes not via the arts but the artists has indeed found voice suddenly after 2014. Let's not make any bones about it. Suddenly, you know, you look at classical music, which perhaps Tansen used. You know, he sang Rag Deepak to light a lamp and Meg Malhar to, you know, for Varuna to be pleased. And Amrita Varshini sung for people to get rain. And this art was suddenly used, assuming or seemingly to overthrow a government that was democratically elected. See, your audiences really need not be the Delhi government always. Yes, and the Delhi government is not going to be a permanent, the present Delhi government. I don't think I will have any, you know, qualms in uttering their name either. The present Delhi government is not your audience. For an artist, for a Carnatic vocalist, the Delhi government is not the audience. The audience is the audience that seeks the art, not your activism. And, you know, your voice of dissent and, you know, and how dissent is important in democracy. I think if you want to bring about change, that's not by overthrowing the present government through your art. You need to do a lot more than that.
I just wanted to add to Malavika. I wanted to say that, you know, the whole world of arts in its entirety, including, I mean, the performing and the visual arts, is so lobby-driven. And I think unless we break that lobby-driven methodology and bring some transparency, because that is how the whole of the world of arts is monopolized. And we must understand that arts and artists do, the monopolized lobbies do have a narrative, that we are all together trying to change today. And unless we are able to break that unstructured lobbying that exists and bring transparency, the narratives are not going to shift, and the artists will continue to play these games, whether it is truly activism or not.
Yes, please. Can somebody put in the mic here?
Hi. Recently, what happened is in Tamil Nadu, now we have been speaking about the performing arts, the visual arts, but let's move to the other arts, which is, you know, painting, drawing, and so on. In Tamil Nadu, in Loyola College, what happened is they had an art exhibition where the Hindu symbolisms and Hindu representations have been extremely derogatively portrayed. So I, being a common normal Hindu, how should I respond? If I draw a cartoon to give it as an, a response like as an offensive defense, then the blasphemy law will chase me. You know, this law doesn't chase the other people, God knows why. And if I draw and put it in Facebook, and I don't know whether I'll be alive tomorrow or not, how should I respond and to stop all this? Or, yeah, anyone could answer, please.
I think calling it out has become, I mean, thanks to social media, calling out the these narratives, these artistic political narratives, I think the very fact that this was called out on social media brought it down. So I think that's the only way now, considering the way the law is laid out.
Yeah, please.
Hello. My respect to all the panelists. Actually, I would like to ask question to the Vivek sir. Actually, I'm from the JNU. Rohit naam hai mera. And from the Maharashtra.
Mujhe aapse darna chahiye ki?
No. Okay. I'm from the Maharashtra. Okay. In kind of Me Too moment, I just want to ask the question. Like, in few months back, the Tanushree Datta put a case on like Nana Patekar. Whether it was a case, I don't know about that. But how one can that...
She also put a case on Jesus Christ. Do you
absolutely
know
that? That's not problem. But actually the problem is that how you can say that after 8 years, you are putting someone, the respectable actor. So in my case, if someone getting harassed by someone, so it is need to put case instantly. Okay. So I find a kind of fallback in that case. Okay. So I...
Can I also request the audience, because I made the this rejoinder before, can we have a question beyond the Me Too movement? Ma'am, yes, sir, please. No, your question is valid, but it's been debated ad nauseum on the panel. Yeah.
Yeah, actually, I was just surprised. The title was Activism. We are speaking more of Me Too here. Because I was very much upset. The worst thing I would like to say here is, if activism had not been there, T.M. Krishna, the song which is a song for the deity, Dasana Madikoyanna, and those songs which are coming from the innermost conscience as a form of worship, you cannot use the raga, you cannot use the same lyrics and use it against our own system of worship. If the activism had not been there, we would not have been able to project it into the entire world. US would not have cancelled his concerts. My humble submission is, the performing artists, are they having any kind of a responsibility towards the society in portraying the art forms in the way they were supposed to be portrayed? Are they having any responsibility or not?
Would you want to respond to it, Swarnamalya ji?
No, I think artists definitely have to be very, very responsible. I also would like to say that artists have to be very aware. Like you rightly said, sir, I think I really appreciate how he put, he said, without activism, one wouldn't have been able to raise a voice against something. So I think what we are debating here is whether activism is legitimate or not. It is very important, because without that, it is very, very, very difficult to raise a voice and to bring about a change that we want. Whether that change happens or not, I think it's very important to register our dissent or our disagreement. And when artists have to be aware, I think they have to be aware of their position. Not all artists can take the same position. And as long as we are okay, as long as we are okay that there are different artists with different opinions, varying standpoints, and if the artist is completely aware of their standpoint, then we also as audience can take an opposed view or an agreeable view. I mean, art is consumable. So if you walk into an auditorium, you know what you're walking into. Whether it be a performing art or a visual art or it be, you know, the media, I think we all know what we are watching or what we are going to watch. So I think, like Coleridge said, there is suspension of disbelief, but also there is a tremendous amount of belief in knowing what you're going to watch.
Malavika ji, I think you fundamentally disagreed with the version that Swarnamalya ji has been putting out in your initial remarks also. How do you respond to the conversation which just happened?
No, I think I began by saying what he just did. I began by saying, please understand your form and the purpose of that form and use it for the purpose it is meant for. If your form is meant to communicate a certain content, then do so. Are you going to now start composing Bharat Tere Tukde Honga in Shankaravarnam and Todi because that's your opinion? Tell me please. There is a purpose to your form. It came from the Samaveda. Understand the purpose to the form and use it responsibly. You have an opinion on JNU or on the Tukde, please do so. But should you use your art as the vehicle? Please, you are the use the artist that you are as the vehicle. Let me see what audience you get.
I would like to add something. The problem today is that anything which attacks India and Hinduism and the middle class values, that is called activism. Yeah. Right. Now, abusing the country, Raj Kapoor, Guru Dutt, Mehboob Sahab, all of them were leftist, hardcore communists. But they made their movies, their activism was against poverty, was against caste problem. It was never against India. But today's artists, being a leftist, being rebelling, the dissent, the so-called dissent, why the dissent is only against India and Hinduism, let me tell you one thing. Asking for Ram Mandir in Ayodhya is also a dissent against that fundamental Babri Masjid. Why isn't that called activism? Today, if I choose to make a movie on Ram Mandir issue, they'll say it's a propaganda. You start abusing Ram and Krishna, they will say it is activism. Now, this kind of hypocrisy must be exposed. People like T.M. Krishna must be exposed. They have done such disservice to this nation. You cannot imagine the younger generation. They are doing gaslighting. And they blame others for gaslighting. In fact, they are doing dim lighting, make everything so blurred that nobody knows what is correct and not. And then you take over and say your religion, your customs, everything are regressive.
I think the fact is that artists have to be responsible because their narrative, their voice is heard far more than the common man. And hence, if you're really getting into any activism, it has to be from a space of personal journey. Otherwise, it is just propaganda and activism. And I, as Vivek ji said, you know, a lot of money flowing into the bank accounts.
Yeah, I'd like to add that there is okay. Yeah, let's take the question.
I think the time's already
all
up.
All right. Okay.
No, but you can give your closing remark, and then we can.
No, I just wanted to say that. I agree with Malavika ji to the extent that one has to be very true to their form. But I think we should also understand that the form that we understand it as has a tremendous amount of diversity in it. As much as we have all the, I'm a classical dancer or a Bharatanatyam dancer, and so I am soaked in all of the things that she mentioned, but other than that, there is also the music of, say, Kunnangudi Mastan Sahib. There is also the music of other artists which have had tremendous historical value. They are not created now in the 21st or the 20th century. So one has to also take that into account. As long as there is no tampering with the originality and the original compositions or, you know, the original standpoint of the composer or the artist, I think everybody has a space of their own, and I think that is allowed. And as long as they are aware of their space and confident about it, and we are aware of it, and we know how to take a standpoint, either opposing or agreeable, I think we're all fine.
Thank you so much, all of you. I think for me, it was a really, a very enriching experience because I've studied literature, and this debate whether of art versus activism goes back to the theories that we studied in the classroom. So I thank each one of you for giving your time for this panel, and thank you so much. Thank you.